to discuss about different applications of ICT in different areas, like in government, in medical field, in education field, different fields. We discuss how IT is applied, and we discuss about the education, we discuss about e-business, e-learning, and also about e-health or e-medicine, telemedicine, different machineries which are used for different diagnosing purposes, right? And now we have come to this this home health management and all. So these parts actually we didn't discuss. So home health medicine or home health management is like, so there are some patients. So there are some patients who are taking treatments at home. Even in this COVID situation, you know, even in this COVID situation, some patients are treated. So they are at their home. So then the continuous monitoring is needed. So if you're affected, or if your neighbor or a friend is affected from this COVID-19 pandemic, and so if he or she is suffering from the suffering from this COVID-19, then you can ask them, so what kind of treatment that they got. So mostly it is home health medicine, right? So mostly they ask, the patient is asked to be at home and monitor. Actually, this is not fully online system. What they do is they ask you to monitor your oxygen level and report them time to time, maybe each half an hour, each hour. You are asked to report the oxygen level. In case of a sudden drop in the oxygen level, they will arrange emergency care. So, but that is not fully online. But other countries, I saw the most of the countries, they are having systems to monitor. So not just in COVID, so in some other situations also, heart patients, some diabetic patients. So they are monitored at home. And consultation, remote surgery, we discussed. Telemedicine and teletraining. Teletraining is where the medicine-related training is provided to you online and through some simulations. So, you know, there are facilities in some universities. I'm not sure whether it is in Sri Lanka. Some universities, there are facilities to do surgeries using virtual equipments and virtual kind of bodies. So these are like, actual surgeries, but for training purpose. Actual surgeries, but for training purpose, they have virtualized that. And that is with the help of robots and the systems, they do the surgeries for training purposes. Okay, then we discuss agricultural sector for farming. Various devices used to measure the climate changes, weather, even the humidity, in the environment and the soil. So soil quality monitoring. So there are devices. So there are IoT equipments. You have this in grade 9. I'm not sure whether you have done this in grade 9. If not, my advice is please come to grade 9 class as well. In grade 9, you had this subject, IoT. So have you done have you created any system using Arduino in grade 9? Arduino? So can you raise your hand if you have done something using Arduino? At least virtually. Okay, Dimath, you were there, I think. Kusal, yeah, good. Kusal.
I done that from the website, sir.
Website, all right, okay.
Thinkacad
one, right, okay. So that is how we did it. And initially joined people, we have sent the kits also. But nowadays, like, we cannot send the kits due to the cost, you know, that cost has suddenly increased. And initially the cost of the kit was around 3,000, but after charging you the registration fee of 2,500, we were sending that. But now it's not possible, you know, the cost has raised. But still, you can do that practical using Tinkercad website. If you have not done, don't worry. You can come to the grade 9 class while coming to the grade 10 class and learn that. That is possible, right? You can come to the grade 9 while coming to the grade 10 class. And please let me know, have you filled the registration form? Because like there were some students who have not filled the registration forms. If not, kindly fill this, because like this is how we communicate and we find your contact details. I'll share that detail. kindly feel. Let me show that this is the form that I'm expecting you to fill. That is student registration details 2022-1. Kindly fill this if you have not filled. If you have already filled, that is okay. If you have not filled, please fill it. This is how we do communicate with you all. I'll generate the link and send it to you. No need to fill this now, but at least bookmark it and fill it after the class. I have sent it for everyone, right? Okay, so let's go back and let's go to this Arduino thing. Using Arduino, you can create a system to monitor soil, Arduino soil monitoring, basically the soil monitoring moisture sensor. You can use this moisture sensor to monitor the soil. And when so soil is dry, yeah, this is the sensor. And this is the circuit diagram. It's very easy to create. This is how the circuit is created. You have to use LED bulb and just the sensor and some relay or the controller to control that. And also you can connect this to a motor. So why? Then you can create like self irrigation system. So it's look like this. So you can see here.
So what's the meaning of irrigation?
This is drip irrigation self one. Or you know what you call it, like when you want to spread water, when you want to put water automatically. Have you seen these things are there in Noorelli and some other areas, but not controlled using this, but there are timer controls.
My school also have those things, sir.
So in maybe school gardens, yes, you may have that. Then no one need to be there. It will be automatically starting when soil is dry and spreading water, putting water to the plants. So that is very good because like it's automatically controlled, the climate control. And not just that, so you know, these greenhouses, these are completely automated now, not like earlier days. Now, actually I was asking for a quotation since I'm really interested in doing this cultivation and all. So therefore even though I'm in this Western province these days, I was asking for a quotation whether can I start this now to check whether for home gardening purpose actually. That is a small system, but they quoted me around 400,000. But that is fully automated. Even the fertilizer, water, climate control, humidity control, light control, soil quality check, the pest controls. The pest control systems and all, alerting systems, the monitoring, and it's mobile connected. So it is fully automated one. So that is nice to have such things where you can monitor your garden using your mobile phone. Right? Yeah, like if there is a pest, if there is some attack or issue with dryness, some unhealthy plants, you will be alerted to your mobile. So it will be alerted to your mobile. So that is some good thing about this farming. Right, the crop harvesting robots, you know, I saw this some videos, I guess. If not, you can just go and see this apple harvest. There are a lot of things like apple harvesting machine. There are a lot of machines invented around the world, just not to harvest, to collect and pack also. Some are vacuum-based, some are robotic, some are like intermediate like this. So this is like intermediate systems, not fully robotic. It has people and also machineries. People and machineries working together. But this one is, I think, this is also people and machineries working together. It's people and machineries. Again, people and machineries, but there are some fully automated machines where the machine does the harvesting part. Okay? Machine does the harvesting part. There are some components, equipments like that nowadays. Okay, then animals are connected to computers. The advantage is you can get their health information and about that all automatic milking examinations and examination the quality of the milk.
Excuse me, sir.
Yes.
I watched a program about these automated milking and examination of cows. In there, some scientists are said it will hurt to cows lot. other than normal milking?
Yeah, normal milking, some, because like there are sensors, no? There are sensors to detect their status. And without hurting them, there are mechanisms to absorb milk without hurting them much. So you cannot guarantee that it is not 100%.
They gave us some solution that when we put that wire to that, what that means that, so what's the meaning of that?
So basically it absorbs from their breast.
Yes, that when we put that wire to that breast, earlier we put only a iron, but now they use a rubber. So that's
so that makes, so by using the change in the material, so they're yes. trying to minimize the effect, right? So yeah,
yes.
can be something like that. Okay, so not just that, not only that, so they are having like quality monitoring systems using RFIDs. So have you heard of this RFID tracking or RFID systems? Radio frequency identification, RFIDs. Have you seen where these RFIDs are working? Radio frequencies, RFIDs.
In the tunnels?
Yeah, RFIDs can be used anywhere. Right, RFIDs can be used anywhere, even like pet control, you know, the pet monitoring. So for monitoring pets, you are using RFIDs. Pet, you know. To identify your dog or cat and their location and whether it lost or not. To identify the place that it in. So to do that, and not only that, these pets, so other animals also, even vehicle monitoring. So vehicle tracking can be done using RFIDs. So automatically opening gates and tracking the position, place of the vehicle. So where are the global position of the vehicle, GPS and RFID together. Find the location of the vehicle. So if a vehicle is sub-rented, now there are systems to monitor the owner to monitor the location of the vehicle, because it is really important, right? When you rent a vehicle, you have a right to know where the vehicle is. So now there are systems, GSM-based, GPRS-based, GSM, you know, global service for mobile communication. So this GSM-based, GPRS-based, and maybe the internet-based, you need to track your own vehicle where it is after renting. And also, especially these are used in fuel refineries and fuel refineries to the deliver centers, sheds basically. So why? Because there are some frauds happening. There are some issues when transporting these things. Some, you know, drivers and some people, they used to misuse the facility, and in middle they will sometimes sell in this fuel. So that was headache to these people. So what the owners have done, they have connected RFID tracking system or vehicle tracking system to the vehicles to track the location of the vehicle and the speed of the vehicle. So everything can be monitored. But you can see, this is the radio frequency. And this can be used to minimize accidents. And vehicles can communicate with each other using this. Even people cannot communicate, the vehicle can communicate with the nearby vehicle and understand the status of the road, location, and also the speed, accidents. These are really useful in prevention death. Okay. So then farm management, as I said, and fishing industry to monitor and find out the information. There are sensors. So unlike in countries, the developing countries, in developing countries, you know, so after fish farming only, these fish farmers, these people are reporting they are today, it was not good day today. So likewise, but before that, so even these people can use, fishermen can, they can use their mobile to find out the locations, good locations for farming, good location for collections. And so likewise, they can find information about this using automated sensors. Developed countries are using that. Okay, manufacturing industry. This is interesting. So hope you have seen the BMW manufacturing lab, BMW manufacturing plant. I'll show you an image. You can just watch a video. So there are a number of videos online related to that. This is it. And you can see a lot of machines instead of people. So a lot of machines instead of people. The machines are doing the manufacturing process. The entire car or entire SUV.
Also like that now, sir.
Sorry?
So Tesla factory also like that now, sir.
So there are people, but people are there to monitor and maybe support and maybe the quality assurance or some other tasks, but mostly machines. Mostly machines are doing the assembly part of the vehicle. So this is faster, unique, and also, so the accuracy and the production quality and the consistency will be higher than the man-made ones. And anyway, so this is not fully automated. So there are some human interactions too. Because 100% automated automation is really, it's unlikely possible. You know, it's very difficult to do. There are some human intervention is needed in some level. So, but here, so what are the disadvantages?
So doesn't Tesla do that?
Sorry? 99% 9 possible. Again, not 100%. 99% 9 possible. So even though they tell 100% we can do, yes, that is okay. But at least without a selling person. So it's entire process. Somewhere you need people. Somewhere you need people. So 100% replacing machines, not possible. Somewhere you need people, at least in management level, at least in the selling level, somewhere you need people, right? 100% automation is not possible. But you can produce the vehicle, production part, maybe you can automate 100%. But not the entire process of issuing the vehicle to the people who need it. So for that, you need some people. Okay, so, and so one interesting, here you can see computer manufacturing, even the laptop manufacturing, it's automated. So manufacturing packagings, bottle manufacturing, bottle labeling. So all these things are, you know, when you go to a factory, even in Sri Lanka, you can see the full kind of 99% automation in some factories, right? So packaging, it's happening with the automation. And so, you know, construction industry. So 3D printing is possible to use for building printing. 3D printing for building. Buildings can be printed in Dubai. Here, this is an example in Dubai. So not just in Dubai, so some countries, China even using this 3D printing for print buildings. You know, this is kind of a safe house. These kind of houses are called domes. These are eco-friendly. Because, you know, the design itself giving you benefits to prevent, actually protect your house from certain thunderstorms, certain flooding and all. Because design support, designers inbuilt features, this is architectural design which support, these are called dome houses, you can go and search. So this is not traditional, this is dome, right? This is the Italian company. In Italy, you have in Australia, in USA and China, Dubai, these people are using that. So even 4D printing is possible. So what is the 4D and 3D? What's the difference? 4D printing, 3D printing. Lots of difference.
Is that 4D very flexible?
Yes, 4D has flexibility. So basically 4D printing applied for dresses due to their flexibility. 4D printing applied for dresses. So the idea is this. So normal 3D printer need to be at least, actually it need to be in the size of the dress. The height of the printer should be fit to the dress size. Because in 3D printing, the idea is to print the full dress. But in 4D printing, you can see the second image. 4D printing is thinking about, it's having some intelligence, thinking about folded dress. You know, we store dresses in cupboards, right? We store dresses in cupboards after folding. So then it will take very less amount of space to keep the dress. So 4D printing uses that technology. It is printing the folded dress. So this one, it's printing this folded one. So what is the advantage? Saving the space, and the size of the printer will be smaller. Unlike this 3D printer dress. 3D printing, they need much space. But 4D printing can be done in a less space. Yes, because you know, after folding, so the size of the dress will be. But this, like expansion, there's an algorithm for expansion. Otherwise, like you can't expand after print. But to expand or the make it like looks like this after printing, there's an algorithm to expand. So 4D printing is interesting area in apparel printing nowadays. Okay, so 3D printer, you can create by your own. I advise you, if you can, try this. 3D printer can be created by your own. If you know a little bit of Arduino, so maybe your grade 9 knowledge will be enough. So you can create a 3D printer. Actually, this was interesting video that I saw in internet. I'll show it to you as well. This particular girl, what she has done, she has created her own printer. She has created a 3D printer and printed some clothes. She has printed some clothes. And after printing, she has done here the first fashion collection 3D printed at home. Complete DIY. This is in 2015, right? 6 years back. DIY. DIY means do it yourself. Do it yourself. There are interesting projects which you can do by your own. So this girl has done a DIY. She has created a DIY, do it yourself printer. She has created that, and using that, she has printed some dresses and conducted a fashion show. Okay, HRM and video conferencing like we do now. So no need to give examples. HRM, fingerprinting and all. So we are using that. Online shopping, of course. I saw you enough example last day also. And transportation for traffic monitoring, traffic control, automatic traffic control. And you know, the traffic in, even if you put Google Maps, how it gives whether the traffic status?
How it Google also say that there's a traffic like that.
Yeah, how it tells that. So what is the, like, what is the, so how we detect the traffic? What is the algorithm? What they do? Are they monitoring using cameras?
No.
They?
Satellites?
No, not. So they are using satellites, but that is not the main way. So basically they use like, you know, SOM computing or like, you know, so they can get information from the other vehicles, right? So that is something easier. So let's say you put Google Maps and you go in front of me. There's another one put in Google Maps and go in front of me or in front of you. Just give me a second. Hello? Right. Okay, then so what I was telling is about the Google Maps. Google Maps, basically they use that is not their fundamental way, but they are actually getting information from other vehicles also. Let's say a few people are So most of the people are having that map feature in their mobile phone, in their vehicle maybe. So then the other vehicles can share the traffic information too. So this is like RFID information sharing. The other information which go in front of me can share the traffic information too. So based on that, based on the response from some vehicles, it's updating the vehicle status. Not just that they are using the hybrid approach, not just a single approach. They are using satellite technologies. They are using other speed measuring technologies, like heuristic. Heuristic means previous experience. So all these things, all this information is hybrid AI, artificial intelligent approach, and that is how they provide. Vehicle auto parking systems, vehicle identification systems, and you know, even in highways, have you seen this electronic entrance in highways? When a vehicle comes, highway gate is automatically opening. When a vehicle comes, the highway gate is automatically opening. How it happens? Right, it has like vehicle has and sticker. Vehicle has a small sticker in front of that. And when the sticker is actually sticker is read by the sticker is read by what do you call image reading or a camera, and using that camera, the database is searched. We will learn about the database in the last lesson, right? So that is our grade 10 last lesson, that is about databases. We will learn. So that above, by reading the information in the database, so that is a data store. So it has all the information about the registered vehicles. So it accesses those registered vehicles, information from those registered vehicles, and through that vehicles, to that vehicle database, it is detecting this person is a valid person and opening the gate. This happens instantly. Otherwise, like, you have to wait in a queue, no? But there are no queues in these electronic entrances. When your vehicle is going through, or the walking or riding through, when you ride through or when you drive through that gate, it will automatically detect, instantly read the database, read the records in database, and then do the acceptance and open the gate. So that is automated process. So parking identification, not only that, not only the parking identification in that automatic entrance, automatic tracking systems also. So this is, you know, this is most interested area, that is entertainment. You all are using ICT for entertainment. I hope once in life, at least one time in life, you listen to a music using your computer or mobile phone. At least once in your life, you watch a video or movie.
Every day.
Every day. So that is the thing. So entertainment is the topmost service that you are using ICT. So what else, other than movies, other than this videos, audios, what else you have in entertainment?
Photo edit, sir.
Sorry?
Doing photo edit, sir.
Yes, photography, photo editing.
Digital art.
Mobile. Sorry. Photography, I do, sir.
Okay.
Graphic design.
Graphic design.
Digital programming.
There are more things. Gaming. What do you think about gaming? Games. Computer games. So that is also part of entertainment. Anything? Reading books?
I don't play games, sir.
And you don't play games. Okay.
I don't.
But it's okay to not to play games, but you have to develop a game at least once, right? Because the game developing
games from scratch, sir.
Yeah. Developing games will develop your thinking ability. Playing games will also develop. But playing games, sometimes it's like addictive, no? Some people are addicted to games, no? That is also bad. It is not good to addict to the games, but gaming will develop your logical thinking ability. Remember that, right? Now don't explain your parents how the Dasansa said that gaming will develop our logical thinking ability, Amma. Therefore, I'm playing games every day. Because my lecturer advised me to do that. Don't really like that. No, I didn't advise to do that. I'm just telling. So some games, not every game, some games are constructively affecting your brain. So those are called brain games, actually. Puzzles-like games, you know. Puzzles.
And sir, choose some differences between two pictures.
Yeah. Mathematical games. You have mathematical games, puzzle games. So there are difficult games in difficult
now life. There are some jobs we want to multiple some maths.
I'll tell you one interesting one. So if you can, so this is not a game actually, this is a puzzle, but it uses mathematics. You can try to solve this. This is a common mathematic problem. So this will really help you develop your mathematics skills. Next day, try to solve, not now. I'll show, tell the game name. There is family. I think you have a solution for this family and the bridge. So family and the bridge. Don't go for the solution. Solution is already there in the YouTube. When you go and search the solution, you don't play the game because you know the solution. So go on, go and get the solution, but just find the game. This is IQ game. These are called like brain games or IQ games. Because you need to solve a problem, you need to think logically to solve this problem. So here you have a family. In this family, actually Gina, Ken, Lisa, Tom, Cindy, and Oman. So these are the people in this family. So the logic says here, these are the instructions. Instructions are there, but I'll explain this for you. So where you can go and play this, but not now, after the class, please. Otherwise, I'm in big trouble. So I'll share the link. Just go and watch this and try to play and get the solution, but after the class, right? Okay, these each of these, all of them need to go to the other side of the bridge. Here, all of them need to go to the other side of the bridge. But what they have to do is, like, these different people will take different amount of time. Gina will take only 1 second. Yes.
Sir, you send us that Google form.
That's so. Wait. Resending. Resending.
Oh, no, okay, sir.
Okay, Gina will take. Right. Gina will take only 1 second, whereas Ken will take 2 seconds. Lisa will take 4 seconds. Tom takes 6 seconds. And Cindy is 8. Actually, she's taking 8 seconds. And Oman, 12 seconds. But altogether, you have 30 seconds because lamp will go off after 30 seconds. So always one person should carry the lamp. You can't throw the lamp from other side to this side. So always one person should carry the lamp. For an example, let's say Gina and Ken is moving from the other side. So it will take total of 2 seconds to them to move because, you know, the slowest one will be Ken, and Ken will take 2 seconds. So actually Gina has to follow Ken. Therefore, both will take 2 seconds to go other side. Now we have only 28 seconds. So you need to carry the lamp and come back. So let's say Gina is coming back after carrying the lamp and go again, and you can see. So it will take another 1 second, and now you have 27 seconds as the total, right? So likewise, you have to carefully understand and solve the problem. So let's say Gina and they are moving, and so they will take all together 4 seconds to move other side. Then let's say Gina to come back. It will take another So don't try to play this now, play it after the class, right? So let's move to the next part. This is about the entertainment that we learn, entertainment portion of the ICT. Gaming, photographs, watching TV, live streaming, and watching videos, social media, you know, Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, LinkedIn. Those are also Instagram. Those are also coming under this ICT in entertainment. Different things. E-reading, e-books and all. So demerits, or you know, props and cons. Both props are there, also cons are there. Goods are there, bads are there. Advantages are there, disadvantages are there. That is the nature of any subject. So mostly those who think this is not good, this is bad, always think about the bad side and avoid using ICT. But that is also not good. You know, if you take knife in your home, it has good sides and bad sides both. The good side is it helps us to cut food, fruits, etc. and prepare food for our meals. So that is the advantage. But you know, if you use it like unprofessional way, even you can kill a person using a knife. But thinking that it can kill a person, so are we going to avoid that? Is there any home, any house without knife? Thinking that this can kill people. So, you know, the knife is dangerous, right? It can cut the neck and kill someone. So, but thinking like that, are we going to avoid that completely? No. Every house, you have knife. Internet and ICT is also like that. By thinking that somebody is going to hack you, by thinking that there are some unwanted sites like pornography sites, unwanted adult content and all, thinking that there are some risk to your privacy, identity theft. So you can't avoid that fully. Because you know, there are some advantages. We have to think about advantages and use that ethically and securely. You are not going to give the knife to 1-year-old baby in your house. No? So this is also like that. Now you all are teenagers. You all are teenagers, so you know the goods and bads. You know the ethics. You know what is good, what is bad. So you can understand it. So you can use it securely. So that is our advice. Okay, addiction is one bad thing, you know. So that is, in anything, you know, addiction is very bad. So sugar is, it's like cocaine, heroin-like thing. So, but you know, almost all Sri Lankans are addicted to sugar. That is bad habit. Taking sugar is, it's not good to your health. But people are addicted. So when analyzed, even doctors are telling that it's like cocaine and heroin. It's like some drugs. It's dangerous. The addiction is dangerous as that. But you know, almost all Sri Lankans addicted to that, including us. Anyway, addicted to the ICT is also giving some bad results. So some people, even in the night, they wake up and start checking their mobile phone for SMSs, WhatsApp messages, and late updates in the Facebook and all. So they think there's a message always. That is called...
Most of the Sri Lankans are like that, sir.
Yeah, that is called SAD. That syndrome is called SAD. SMS addiction disorder. Sometimes it can go mad. Message addiction disorder. Right? So it is sad and mad. So then there's something called PAD, which is phone addiction disorder, mobile phone, actually. So you can call them PAD, and mobile phone addiction disorder. So that is also a problem. So you always think there's a message, there's something, there's a call coming, there's a missed call, and you used to check your mobile phone regularly. Without any reason, you check the mobile. So means you're addicted. So you have to think, right? So if people are getting angry, changing the moods time to time due to mobile phone, that is due to this MPAD or SAD or MAD disease.
Sir, excuse me, sir.
Yes.
Sir, addicted to the hobby is also harmful or not, sir?
Depends on the type of hobby. So any kind of addiction is bad. Any kind of addiction.
Mobile photography, sir, is that?
Sorry?
Sir, mobile photography. graphy that is that harmful?
You cannot say it's harmful, but some, so always there is a time that you should avoid that.
Okay.
So something like this.
So what about, so what about reading book? Is that bad if it's addictive?
Reading books is also, so nothing, so it's, you cannot say addiction is bad, but the thing is, sometimes if you are getting angry due to that over addiction, so that is bad. Like it's how you manage your emotions. Okay, let's say somebody has moved your book from one place to another place and you are getting angry for whole day due to that. So that is bad addiction. It is how you control your own emotions. So that means even though you are addicted, you should be able to control the emotions based on the situation. Let's say you are going to a funeral and start reading books. So now what? Right? You are going to a wedding function and start reading books there. So that kind of things you need to avoid. So your practices should be there. The hobby should be there. But situation to situation, you have to control your behavior. So that's the thing. Right? Otherwise, any kind of addiction can go back. Okay. So then building unsuitable relationships, because relationships and friendships, because we don't know from the other side who's, let's say you are chatting. So we used to chat earlier days in our teenage. We used to chat with the people, anonymous people. Actually, our ambition was to build the English language. To enhance our language skill, we used to chat. So that is okay. No harm.
Hey, sir.
Yes.
Sir, how can we find the addresses of another country's children?
So basically, there are some groups, right? Chat groups. So related to yeah.
To get the children as parents, sir.
Yes, there are conferences, and I saw one interesting conference that I can advise you to join also, but it cost you some amount, around $9, means like 2000 rupees. So that was something that I can, that is Model Union. So I think it is United States Model Union, where you can find a lot of friends there, right? United States Model Union, right? This is like UN Model Union. Model United Nations. So it's like you're acting like a country representative, right? You're acting like, so there was one in USA and there's one in India also. I'm not sure there's one in Sri Lanka. So there are actually, you have to take a role. You have to take a role to represent a country in the world and act as the country representative in United Nations conference. But that is a model union, right? Not actual. So I just joined one time and I was acting like a Singapore representative in a UN Model Union. And there was another girl who joined from Sri Lanka. She was acting as Vietnam representative in that model union. Actually, that is one good thing because you can debate about the world and world politics and about the world situation, certain pandemic situations and trends about the education. You can participate to different conferences like UNICEF, UNESCO. You know, these things are there in your book. You can actually participate and get the exposure and experience how they are talking. There are moderators to help you. And you can build network. We can build friends. And you can talk with other country students also. So that is one thing that I can suggest. These model unions are there. So other than that, so most of the chats are now like, it's like misused by some people. So these anonymous chats cannot be trustworthy nowadays, but earlier days there were like some academic chat groups, but now actually it's rare. Other than these model unions, I have not seen any very good chat engine. If I saw, I'll definitely suggest you. But this iMoon is Indian one. UMoon is, I think, this is NMoon or the national, this is National Model United Nations. So I think the Indian one is iMoon. Indian one. Hello. Okay, so let's move back. Right, then, so next we have to come to the history of computer and how it evolves. So this is like a historical lesson. It's like story. Don't take this much because anyway, you will be asked few questions from this, but just read. Just read about the history, it is also needed. So when I said there will be few questions, some are like not interested to be in the lecture also. I don't know why. Because of the history, maybe, né? History, Pythonics, it's like me, something like that. Okay, so let's learn about the past history of the computer. Actually, computing world, there are a lot of innovations. So initial abacus, this is the picture of initial abacus, was even around 5,000 years ago. So it's ancient. But this is, you know, it is not a machine even, it's a manual kind of method for, you cannot call it a machine, it's a manual kind of method for calculating. Then, so there's another evidence, they have given some facts. The second fact that they have given about the Pascaline machine. This is what the Pascaline is. Pascaline is actually created by Blaise Pascal. So this machine was, this is like a, you can see it has some wheels. It's not electronic, it's manual. It's not electronic, it's manual one. So basically you can control these wheels and do some arithmetic. So it was created for addition and multiplication initially, but it was developed to the next stage of like multiplication, subtraction and division. It was developed to that stage by another person called, so just Joseph Jacquard. So sorry, this Gottfried Wilhelm. So he's the one who developed this Pascaline to do some additional calculation, because this was just addition machine, adding machine. Initial Pascaline was just for adding. But in 1674, this Gottfried was developed this to calculate division, multiplication also. Okay, then the third point is like Joseph Jacquard, who came up with a looming machine. Looming machine means, you know, to create dresses and all. This is Jacquard loom. This is called Jacquard loom. It's a big machine, but this is not a computer, right? So don't think this as a computer. This is for automated looming, programmed looming. That means like there should be a person to create the dresses, no? There should be a person to create this. But without using a person, so what Jacquard has done, he has given an instruction sheet. This instruction sheet is called punch card. So what is punch card? Punch card is a paper. Punch card is a paper with some holes. Can you see? These are punch cards. All these are punch cards. So these are punch cards. Punch cards are, it's like this. It's a piece of paper which you have holes in different places. Piece of paper with holes. So you can see the Jacquard has done, he inserted this paper with holes. Actually, it was a pattern. It was a program. He inserted this piece of paper. It has holes. According to this hole pattern, there's a weaving pattern. The fabric is created according to this hole pattern in, actually he failed. So that is why you can see it's not a big, not a small thing. It's a big set of papers. When they insert this, the looming happen or weaving happen according to the instruction that he has fed. So that was the Jacquard loom. That is not a computer, but why this is important? Through that, people understood that it is possible to keep storages, it is possible to input things, and it is possible to program these machines with some instruction. As the programmable machine concept was first introduced by John von Neumann, he called stored program concept to that. Stored program concept, John von Neumann, you can see. And actually, before John von Neumann, somebody has created a program. So she is called actually the first programmer. Can you remember her name? The first programmer. What's the name of that? Her.
Ada Augusta Lovelace.
Yes. The lady Ada Augusta Lovelace. She was named as the first programmer. Actually, she was writing programs to the Charles Babbage. He's the father of computing. He was writing programs to this Charles Babbage's analytical engine. Actually, it was a concept or the module developed by him. It was later developed into an actual machine. Because like in 18th century, Babbage has come with this analytical engine concept. Babbage, analytical. Babbage's analytical engine. So Babbage, not Babbage, Babbage. This is the analytical engine concept by Babbage. Actually, he was developed the conceptual machine. Right? Later it was, right, it was created as an actual machine. In here, this is 1937, what he suggested as the model. Actually, the actual machine was developed in 1880s. And using his engine, it was just engine, right? Like car engine. So it has some valves, like it has some levers, valves, and all. So using this engine, a computer was created in Harvard University that is called Mark I. So you can see the size of computer. It's like a large hall. It's like a large hall. Tons of, like several tons, several thousand kilograms. The weight was several thousand kilograms. It was not possible to move this machine from one place to another place. Developed in the Harvard University. So it's called Harvard Mark I. And using the conceptual engine of Charles Babbage, and this is actually a computer. It can do some calculation as a computer, but it's having a key control room. It's not a keyboard actually, a key control room, a different room for controlling purpose. So imagine the size of machine. It's not possible to move. This is in the university and Department of Defense. Some machines were there, but it was not possible to move that machines. But in the second generation computers, these generation computers, what was the technology in the first generation?
Vacuum tubes.
Vacuum tubes. Vacuum tube is a structure where a tube without air, it's vacuumed, a tube without air, and it is used as a switch. And it is used as a switch for creating. It was a basic element. This is, so basically it's like half feet of size, but later with the time, the size of the vacuum tube was reduced. Later with the time, there were small vacuum tubes too. But in the second generation, the scientist came with some interesting finding that is called transistor. And you can see the size comparison of the transistor and the vacuum tube. Transistor was like half a feet long, and this is only a few millimeters. The transistor was interesting gadget. So due to what happened when you shift from vacuum tube to transistors, the size of the computer is drastically reduced. The tons of, like several tons weight computer was reduced to several kilograms. So this was the second generation computer, let's say IBM 7030 is an example for second generation such computer. You can see the drastically size was reduced. It's like a cupboard. It's like a cupboard. Right? It's like a cupboard. Right? Size of the computer was drastically reduced. And this is using the second generation transistors. Right. Okay. The next is integrated circuits. The next is integrated circuits, that is the third generation. IC or integrated circuit. It was even smaller than transistors. No, it was not smaller than transistors. Then what has happened? Which is smaller, transistor or IC? So what do you think?
IC.
Is it IC or transistor? Okay, this is actual picture. So which is smaller, transistor or IC? Transistor was small, right? Transistor was smallest, but not IC, not the other one. Transistor was smaller, but not the IC, right? So then how computers became even smaller after the transistor? This is IBM, let's say IBM International Business Machine 360, which was like created using transistors. You can see the size of machine. It's like a refrigerator, fridge. So the size is like a fridge. And you can see small keyboard, right? Small keyboard and a printer, which was helping to create you the input and outputs. No monitors, still no monitors, right? So monitors were there, but not famous. Screens actually, not monitors actually. Screens were there, not famous. Mainly they used the keypad, keyboard, and the printer component. So this is 316. So how then machines became smaller? Actually this IC has several hundreds of transistors inside that. So that is the secret, right? So transistor was smaller than IC, but several transistors were integrated into IC. Here inside this, hundreds of transistors were there inside the structure. You can see. If you like enlarge and see, there are hundreds of transistors inside that. That is how IC is created. It's a micro level thing, something like this. Okay, so that is how the computer was even more smaller. And you can see the first generation used vacuum tubes and punch card for inputs. We saw input output and storing data. Punch card was used. Then the machine language and the assembly language was used. What is that? What is machine language? What is assembly language? Any idea? What is machine language? What is assembly language?
I can't understand, sir.
Yes. Can you repeat?
I can't understand, sir.
Machine language. Okay. So can you understand how bulbs are working?
Yes, sir.
How do we give instructions to bulbs? When you turn on the switch, bulb will turn on. When you turn off the switch, bulb will turn off. When you turn on the switch, bulb will turn on. And when you turn off, bulb will turn off. Simply giving, so you can represent that using ones and zeros, right? Giving one will turn on, giving zero will turn off. One means on status, zero means off status. So this is what electronic devices can understand. So that is called machine language. One zeros, ons, offs, on, off, on, on, off, off, on, off, off, on, off, on, on, off, off. Likewise, on, off status. So that is called the machine language. Initially, everything was given in this on, off status. Turning on switches, turning off in switches. Controlling the switch behaviors. So that is how the instructions were given to the computer. Then computer will do calculation according to the instructions given. Okay, that is what happened in the previous time. Then come to second generation. So then not in the actual second generation, the assembly language is actually short format of the machine language. In assembly language, few part were used. So it's like this. So let's say you have 10101101, something like that. So that can be shortened. So a binary can be shortened into a special code. Let me show something to you to understand. Okay, let's say binary machine language is something like this. Right? Then to short this machine language, right? So there were some words used. Let's say this part, I'm telling hello, and this part input, something like that. So part by part, some word were used. So let me show this practically. Right, let's say this is a Java file and I'm just writing a Java command to see the intermediate code of that. Java p minus v, hello on dot class. Actually, this is somewhat intermediate code looks like. Not the exact same, but this is how it looks like. Some wordings. Some wordings were there, but this wordings are like, the wordings are a bit, like bit techie, tech words. So normal person cannot understand. I know you cannot understand this. Even I cannot understand this, don't worry. Because I can actually understand, but since I learned the bytecodes and all, bytecode reading, but actually as a normal person, I will not be able to understand. For sure, you will not understand. So just read it out. Read these things. So what's the meaning of this? Can anyone tell the meaning by reading this?
The spaces what we use for that hello world.
No, not the spaces. It's a calculation. It's a maths. It's a mathematical calculation. Can you tell now? So what kind of calculation it is? Actually, this program represents a mathematical calculation. Right? So it's difficult to understand, right? It's difficult to understand, I know. If you have not done programming before, so it will be very difficult. So don't worry. No need to understand. No one will ask you to write assembly code in your examination. And so they will only ask, so what is assembly? Then what is the answer that you have to tell? It's an intermediate language used to make the machine language easier. It's an intermediate language which was used to make the machine language easier, because machine language is binaries. So binaries means ones and zeros. This 1-0 language, very difficult to understand by human beings. It's very difficult to write, it's lengthy. Therefore, there is something called machine, so assembly code. Assembly language is intermediate language, actually which cannot be understood by human beings and which cannot be understood by machines even. They go lanta patirin. Human beings cannot understand and machines cannot understand. Then who can understand this language? That problem should come to your head. We cannot understand this and machines cannot understand this, both. But this 1-0 language, at least machine can understand. Even though we can't, machines will understand. But this assembly language, machines also cannot understand and we also cannot understand. Then what?
The binary language can understand it.
No, there is a way to convert this to binary. That is called assembler. And there's an intermediary. This is not assembler, but I'm showing. There's an intermediary which can help. Okay, this is that intermediary. I'm asking that intermediary to understand. Okay, it's a 55. Now at least you will realize, you will understand what is happening there. Here you have 10 and here you have 45. So what it does to generate 55?
It added.
Added, yes. 10 plus 45 is 55. So this is intermediate code to add that two numbers. 10 plus 45 is, but see how lengthy it is. But unlike this, binary is even more lengthier than this, right? Binary will be more lengthier than this. This is something to be happy because this is short version. But people still didn't like this. So they came up with another language which called high-level language. Let me show that to you. So this program is in Java, which is written in high level language. Just see whether you can understand this program. See whether you can understand this program. I'm opening that. Just go through this.
So is the JavaScript?
Can you understand that code? I think that will be little bit easier. I know it is not.
So is that JavaScript?
It is Java, Java programming language, right? You don't have Java, don't worry. But so at least you can get some idea right here. A equal 10. B equal 45, C equal A plus B, then print C. You can get some idea using this, right? So this is the third level language. We call third generation language. And don't confuse, don't be confused. Sometimes you might confuse with this language, languages. The generations that you are learning are not the language generations. Those are hardware generations, right? Here you can see machine language, assembly language, both used in which first generation. High level language came in the, I'm sorry, assembly and high level both used in the second generation. Therefore, programming language generations are not the same. High level languages means these kind of languages. It's easy. I'll show you another high level language. This one, can you try to understand this one? Okay, there's a table here. This is also high level language. So there's a table and table name is student. It has some data. You can see the student ID, first name, last name, class, date of birth, gender and all. You have some data in this table. Now you can see those data in this tabular format. This is table with some data. How you write the fourth generation language, actually some high level language to get. So let's say I need to get the first name as well as the gender of the student. I can write a language like this. Select first name, comma, gender from student. See how easy to understand this. Select first name and gender from student. When I run this, it will give me first name and the gender only. Select first name, gender from the student. So these are high level languages, easy to understand. But computers won't understand this directly. Computer need translate this to machine language and understand. So what is the language used by the computers now? What do you think? What's the computer language now?
Binary.
Still binary, right? Still it is binary. Or the machine language. Machine language and binary, same term, right? Same thing. Still computer uses binary. Then why these new languages? To us to use. We can use this high level language and instruct the computer. Computer will translate this and actually he will understand, it will understand that in the binary language. Still it will understand in binary language, right? Okay, when we are doing the programming part in grade 11, we will learn that, right? For the moment, let's don't think much about this. Otherwise, like you will be afraid to learn ICT syllabus. Don't think much about that stuff for the moment. When we learn programming in grade 11, we will carefully learn those things. Okay. Right, let's go to the technologies. Punch card and vacuum tubes in the first generation. And these are some examples. You can see the machines were really large, not portable. Portable means you can't move from one place to another place because it is tons. 5,000 kilograms, can you move that from one place to another place? It's very difficult. You need a ship to bring a computer. Then you need to buy that ship or rent the ship. And buying a computer is like buying a building. So that is expensive. very expensive, and it uses a lot of current, lot of electricity, and very high power heat generation, and slow also. But when it comes to the transistors, so there were some tapes and floppy disks in the usage. Have you seen these tapes? At least the cassette tapes, have you seen? Anyone seen the cassette?
Yes, sir.
Cassette tapes, I think it's those are there in your home, maybe when you search your parents' cupboards, maybe old stuff from your grandfather, grandmother, or some parents. Sometimes you might find this cassette. Similar to this cassette, there are magnetic tapes for the computers. So here, this magnetic tapes looks like this cassette tapes, right? This is what the, sorry, not, this is what the magnetic tape drive looks like. Even for radio storage, you have deck pieces, cassette pieces for audio storage. And computer, for computers, there is a different kind of magnetic tape. So this was the magnetic tape used in the computer. This is used for the storage purpose. You can see this is a modern machine in that era. That time, this was kind of a modern machine. But not now, right? Now we are not using this magnetic tape anymore. This is the tape drive used in those times. And you can see these computers. So, and they are magnetic tapes. Okay. So then we learn about different stuff now.
Sir.
Yes.
How much storage the magnetic tape have?
So it's like, it depends. Some magnetic tapes are having like more storages. So like even it can keep several megabytes of data. But you know floppy disk, it's 1.44 MB. It's a small one, right? This is floppy. It's only 1.44 MB. It's a small storage. Right, 1.44 megabyte. So I had a lot of floppies when I go to my school. Like I went with a lot of floppy drives. Have you used floppy drives? Even I had this kind of floppy, a very large one. This is called 5 and part of floppy, 5 inches. So this is smaller floppy, the 3-inch floppy. Have you seen this 3-inch floppy at least?
No,
maybe
sir.
In your school? No. Okay. I have used some. I had some programs, pictures stored there, and software, operating systems even stored there. Operating system means I store DOS, right? MS-DOS, Microsoft DOS OS inside the floppy. It's because it's only 1.44 MB. But when it comes to tape drive, you can store like 600, even like 1 GB, 2 GB tape drives are there. This is high capacity. These are called high capacity tape drives. Right, high capacity tape storages or tape drives. So this is, these are them. Right, these are some of them, right? So how a tape drives can, so not that, that is not very good. Even the terabytes level tape storages are there. Right, terabyte level tape storages were there. Yeah. 20 terabyte, 15 terabyte.
Sir, does the storage increase by the length of it?
Yeah, with the length and the size. So tape drives are used for this backup purpose, right? Not for the personal usage. Like this is now more than our normal hard disk, no? But these are used in servers for backup purposes. Banks like people, those they are using this high capacity tape drives for backup purposes. That's why this IBM and these people invented this tape drives and those are used. So until modern days, the tape drives are used for backup purposes. Because tape, you can save sequentially, one after another. When you play songs, you have to always move from one song to next song, next song, next song. Like it's random, you cannot move here and there. Always you have to go one by one by one. That's why the tape drives are used for backups. When you want to take that backups, you can take one by one in order, sequential order. That's why tape drives are famous for backups. Okay, this is it. And then comes to the Next generation, so the third generation uses ICs, and use of operating systems came here. 1960s, right? Microsoft DOS, then Windows, those operating systems started in this era, in the third generation. Actually, the use of keyboard and mouse was there. Then in the fourth generation, the monitors or the screens were more popular. Screens and microprocessors were there. Not only the floppy disk, hard disk, optical disks, those also introduced, magnetic disks and all. And large scale integration. So unlike the IC, IC is a small scale integration, but large scale and very large scale integration was used in the fourth generation. And now we are in the fifth one with some artificial intelligence, and it is ultra large scale ULSI circuits, having more capacity, more power than the previous generation. And it is small and portable. You can move from one place to another place, efficient, portable, very less expensive, and it is generating, it's using less amount of memory, and it is high efficiency and reliable. So handwriting, voice recognition, those are the features of this artificial intelligence based machine. You can see, it asks Siri, who is the father of computing?
Charles Babbage.
You can see it's responding, right?
Excuse me, sir, today. How you say it like that, Siri?
I didn't find any appointments for today.
Okay. You can say she's interacting. Actually, she's artificial intelligent, AI bot, right? So you have Cortana in your computer, in Windows computer, if you're using Windows. So that is AI and Google Assistant, Google Voice. You can do the translations. Go to Google and ask, calculate 10 plus 30.
The answer is 40.
You can see calculations can be done. 4,000 Sri Lankan rupees in USD.
4,000 Sri Lanka rupees equals $19.81.
You can see it does the conversion. I like you in Japanese.
In Japanese, you would say, anata ga suki.
It does the translation. It does the calculation. It does the conversion. So whatever you need, Google Assistant or Google Voice is capable of giving you. So that is the nature. If you can talk, so that is what it requires. You can type, you can run, you can recognize, you can calculate. Intelligent features are now integrated to the computer. Okay, with that, the particular lesson, the theoretical lesson, I know it's a bit boring. I tried my level best to make it interesting by showing you examples. I hope I have done some considerable amount of work to show you and give you some interactivity to that lesson. So let's discuss the second part, second lesson next week. And good night. See you all next week.
Good night, sir.
Thank you, sir. Goodbye, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Sir, what languages Arduino use?
Arduino uses C++ and C.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir. Good night, sir.